Morning, Professor.
Hi. Hi, nice meeting you today.
Great. So I'm very sorry for the delay, but we had some issues regarding the timeline and the connection. For anyone is joining from the United States, good morning. For anyone is joining through Tokyo or the Middle East, good afternoon and good night. So I hope that you're enjoying our ground rounds, which is going to be focused today with sinonasal inverted papilloma. I've requested Professor Reda, Kamel, who is a very renowned surgeon, and he's very passionate with this topic. He, in fact, wrote one of the first chapters regarding this for the treatment of sinonasal inverted papilloma through the endoscopic approach. So I think that this task would be perfectly fit from him. For everyone joining, please do remember that we do prefer that you would use your connection through Facebook, YouTube, Twitch, all of our social platforms. And if you have any kind of question, please type your question. We will reply to them at the end of the talk. So please, Professor Kamel, if you could share your presentation. Thank you so much.
Puya, Mubarak, thank you very much for inviting me to be part of such a distinguished webinar. And hopefully it will be a good lecture, because definitely I'm fond of inverted papilloma. And whenever anybody asks me to talk about papilloma, so it's a papilloma, and papilloma again. Now I would like to show my presentation. And to begin with, here we are.
Yes.
So now I would like to talk today regarding sinonasal inverted papilloma. The sinonasal inverted papilloma is a very interesting topic, because definitely during the last 30 years, the evolution of inverted papilloma was definitely a big addition to the field of rhinology. And here we are. The inverted papilloma, local aggressive, definitely it is well known for being locally aggressive, associated malignancy, high rate of recurrence, and tendency to multicentricity. And accordingly, the wide local surgical excision is the dictum. We have to take care of inverted papilloma from the first time, if possible, to remove it completely, to make sure that the recurrence is limited or nil. And I just want to direct your attention that inverted papilloma, is it truly inverted papilloma only, or inverted papillomas? We have a lot of types of inverted papillomas. We have a papilloma like this attached to one of the termis, papilloma attached or originating from the nasal septum, papilloma attached to the onset process, papilloma originating from the bulla, and papilloma originating or arising from the maxillary sinus with the falciform appearance, and then papilloma arising from the frontal sinus. Which what are we going to do for such types of papillomas? It's not only one papilloma, papillomas, a lot of types of papillomas. And in fact, we are lucky, because in the year 1992, we presented our first publication regarding the conservative endoscopic surgery of inverted papilloma. At that time, it was the preliminary report. And at that time, the concept of utilizing an endoscope for inverted papilloma was very strange. And we presented only 3 cases at that time. And then we proceeded with our transnasal endoscopic medial maxillectomy in inverted papilloma. At that time, again, in the year 1995, we presented our work regarding the medial maxillectomy in inverted papilloma, transnasal endoscopic. At that time as well, it was very strange, the inverted papilloma, lateral rhinotomy, and medial maxillectomy. How comes that you perform a transnasal approach for the transnasal endoscopic medial maxillectomy? And then we began to raise the awareness of utilizing the origin as a tool for the classification. And at that time, again, it was very strange. At that these times, or the 2 decades ago, the concept of the origin and the endoscopic approach and utilizing the origin for the classification, the ideas were very strange. And then we presented our classification depending on the origin. And then in the year 2012, we presented our idea regarding how to utilize the origin of the papilloma within the frontal sinus as a tool to plan our surgery, and then regarding recurrence. So we can come now to the how to apply this to our everyday work. Papilloma arising from the turbinate, papilloma arising from the septum, arising from the anterior, from the bulla, from the maxillary sinus, and or from the frontal. So when are we going to perform a transnasal or external, or the extent of surgery? And accordingly, the big change that happened in our work during the last three decades, the change from the dictum of whenever you face a case of papilloma, always lateral rhinotomy and median maxillectomy, but now not anymore. It's transnasal endoscopic resection with very limited exception. And now we have to discuss this accordingly, the different types of papilloma, what is the approach and what is the extent for each type of papilloma of these papillomas. And accordingly, the question is, when are we going to perform the simple transnasal endoscopic resection? Or when are we going to proceed to limited but more difficult spheno-esmoidectomy? And then when are we going to perform more and more difficult operation, the extended medial maxillectomy? And when are we going or obliged to perform the relatively very difficult extended frontal drainage procedure? So now we begin with the very simple transnasal endoscopic resection. I just want to show you this. This is one of our cases, papilloma arising or attached or originating from the inferior turbinate. This is one of the cases performed by one of our the resident using the endoscope. This is not an edited video. And what we are doing here we are the papillary nature of the papilloma, inferior turbinate on the right side. And here we are proceeding, injecting the inferior turbinate at the origin of the papilloma. Here we are after injecting, this is not edited. And here we are after injecting the root, we began to just cut the origin using after injection. Here we are after injection, we began to cut to use the scissors to cut the papilloma. Here we are, this is the scissors from anterior to posterior, incising the papilloma from its origin, not edited by our resident. And here we are, you see here, incising the papillary nature of the papilloma from its origin, and finished. And I just want to stress, there is no good reason at all in such type of papilloma to perform more than the transnasal endoscopic resection. Very simple, and definitely, here we are. This is the situation, the origin, safety margin, and finished. Another case, papilloma arising from the inferior, a very early diagnosis, and that's it, finished. Another case, papilloma arising from the middle turbinate. Here we are. In such a case, we can proceed with the papilloma. We can shave the papilloma using the grasping forceps, throat cutting forceps, and then using the shaver. We have to send all the material for the histopathological evaluation. Why? Because the possibility of associated malignancy. We can appreciate it. This is not simple polyps, but the pathology, papilloma. So the aim of work is to define exactly the site of origin. Now we are following the papilloma till we reach the site of origin using the shaver. The shaver is used to follow, and we can appreciate that the bulla is completely intact and not involved with the tumor at all. And here we are, this is the origin from the lateral aspect of the sinus of the middle turbinate. And here we are, the safety margin, nothing but we can amputate the middle turbinate and the safety margin, and finished. Definitely, the idea of the origin is very, very, very smart. Why? Because using the origin, we define exactly the extent and the approach of the disease. And now we can remove the middle term and finish. This is the idea of using or utilizing the origin. Now, another case of papilloma originating from the bony part of the nasal septum. Another case of originating from the, many cases they are exophytic more than endophytic, but sometimes they are. And according to what we usually do, nothing, but we remove the papilloma with safety margin. The safety margin is nothing but the mycoperiosteum around. So in papilloma arising from the termit and or from the nasal septum, these are the papillomas for the simple transnasal endoscopic resection. There is no need at all to perform anymore. There is no need at all to perform medium maxillectomy or extended procedure. So the other step, when are we going to perform the limited, but more difficult than the simple sphenoethmoidectomy? Whenever we have a case like this, usually lesions arising from the lateral nasal wall, arising from the ethmoid, or arising from the sphenoid, usually they grow. And after growing, they begin to block the maxillary and or the frontal with drainage affection, not extension. And then what we usually have here, you see a case of papilloma arising from the bulla, another case from the bulla. And here we are, what we usually do is to take care of the papilloma within the nasal cavity. And we have to make sure that we could achieve the site of origin. After removal of the site of origin, we can bear the bone underneath or even to resect the piece of lamina or remove the whole bulla. And then we can definitely take care of the maxillary sinus, nothing but suction of the secretion with or without medial metal antrostomy. And we can definitely suck the secretion. And if there is a good indication to remove the bulla because of itis or because of the origin of the disease, we can remove the bulla as well. So here we are, one of the cases, papilloma, here we are, arising from the onset process, arising from the site of calcification up there. What we did here, the MRI was very useful. Why? Because we have here in the CT, opacity within the maxillary, opacity within the nasal cavity, and according and ethmoid. Here, the MRI showed that the maxillary sinus is involved by nothing but collection of secretions because of the blockage of the ostium. And accordingly, what we did here we are, we began to take care of the papilloma using the grasping forceps, and then we began to use, here we are, we removed the big piece. We are allowed to piecemeal removal, but all the material should be sent for the histopathological evaluation. And here we are, we could define exactly the site of origin. The site of origin was nothing but the onset process, ansinectomy, bearing the bone, cauterization, and the finish, limited surgery. And what we did for the maxillary sinus, we did not insert the integrity of the ostium. We left the ostium in peace, and we used our suction tip to suck the secretion from the maxillary sinus. Finish, there is no need for anything else. Now we can plan how to proceed for the extended medial maxillectomy. Extended medial maxillectomy, here we are. What we usually do is to understand how the papilloma from the maxillary sinus behave. Papilloma from the maxillary sinus usually begins within the maxillary sinus, mainly any of the walls, and then it grows. And at that time, usually the patient suffers from sinus problems, and usually receives antibiotic decongestant, saline, and whatsoever, mucolytics. And whenever the papilloma fills the maxillary sinus, it begins to invade the weakest part of or wall of the sinus. And then it grows into, here we are, into the nose. After being within the nose, the patient begins to suffer or complain of the nasal blockage. And at that time, and only at that time, the patient begins to show or to suffer and to go to the doctor. And accordingly, what we usually do is to begin to take care of the nasal part of the tumor. We take care of the nasal part of the tumor. And then we usually take care of the inferior turbinate if it is involved by the disease. If it is not involved by the disease, we leave it in peace. And then we usually take care of the medial wall of the maxillary sinus. We take care of the medial wall of the maxillary sinus. And in many cases, we tailor our medial maxillectomy according to the
Can you hear me, Professor? Professor Kamel? Can you hear me? What's happening? We have some problem. I think that Professor Kamel just left, unfortunately, the meeting. I'm trying to get him back inside of the connection. So in the meantime, if anyone is interested for the questions, I strongly recommend to type your question, because if you're joining from Facebook, YouTube, it doesn't matter, but you have to write down your questions so we will be able to reply in this. Perfectly. We had some issues with your connection,
no
I think.
No problem at all. No problem. Good. I'm ready for everything. And here we are.
Good.
I'm ready. So. Here we are. I will connect again and share again. No problem whatsoever.
Good. Thank you.
So now we can continue. What we usually do is to make sure that we remove the nasal part and then we took care of the inferior turbinate if it is affected, and then we take care of the medial wall of the maxillary sinus, and then we take care of the intramaxillary sinus part of the tumor, and then we define exactly the site of origin of the papilloma, and then we remove the mucosa around. Removal of the mucosa around and burying of the bone at the site of origin, very important, and we can cauterize. In these cases, the most important part is to define exactly the site of origin. And here we are, I just want to show you one of the cases. This is a case of papilloma. This is a case of papilloma. And where is the origin? And according what we usually do here is to ask for MRI. Asking for MRI demonstrate exactly the falciform appearance. The falciform appearance, here we are, the site of origin. And another case, here the transnasal endoscopic medial maxillectomy is feasible. And in the year 1995, it was a very difficult task to publish such an idea in the laryngoscope. And another case, here we are, we have, this is a case of papilloma. And what we did here, you see here, the site of origin is suggested to be the posterior wall. This bony spicule demonstrates or suggests that this is the site of origin. What we did to that case, here we are, this is the situation. We began our surgery taking care of the papilloma. This is the nasal septum, and this is the papilloma. The papilloma, we utilize our grasping forceps to take care of the papilloma. What is very strange in such a case, it was recurrent 13 times. And accordingly, what we did, we removed papilloma. It was very strange. We remove papilloma, more papilloma comes. We remove the papilloma, more papilloma comes. More papilloma is delivered from the papilloma under tension from within the maxillary sinus. And here we are, you can notice and appreciate the nature of the papilloma. The nature of the papilloma bleeding, not like polyps, but we understand the histopathology before surgery. This is a papilloma. Now we are using our shaver. The shaver is used to shave the papilloma. The papilloma within the nasal cavity. We understand more papilloma comes. The origin of the papilloma was fallen. In such a case, the papilloma was originating from the maxillary sinus. So we began to follow. And then we realized that the inferior thermic is engulfed by the disease. And accordingly, we were obliged to amputate it completely. Can you imagine how aggressive the papilloma is? We have to send or the remove the material for the histopathology. And we understand that for the shaver, we have to have a tissue collector to collect all the material. And said that for the serial section, for the histopathological evaluation, we began to proceed with removal of more and more papillomas. And then we began to understand that this is the beginning of removal of, this is the medial wall of the maxillary sinus, shaving the papilloma. And then we began to understand that the turbid is involved by the disease. And you see here, papilloma originated. You have to have patience. The aim of work is not just to remove the papilloma. Inferior turbid is involved with the papilloma. And accordingly, you have to follow the papilloma, to go with the papilloma until you define exactly the site of origin. The inferior turbid is already rarefied, already eaten by the papilloma. And accordingly, here we are, the papilloma originating from the maxillary sinus. Here we are, papilloma in the sphoid. Here we are, is nothing but extension. And then we began to proceed and we could easily identify the frontal sinus. And then we began to take care of the inferior thermit. You see here, cutting the inferior thermit because already eaten. We don't remove the inferior thermit in all cases, but whenever it is involved by the disease, we can proceed. And what we began to do here is to utilize the backbiter to perform the medial maxillectomy. And here we are removing the papilloma. Removal of the papilloma, here we are, it should be sent for the histopathology. The medial maxillectomy is a relatively tough procedure. Here we are, the nasolacrimal duct was involved by the disease as well. Accordingly, we were obliged in such a particular case to cut the nasolacrimal duct and send it for the histopathology. Now we began to utilize the upturned force, the Kamel's upturned force, to take care of the intrasinus part. Till now, we are still using the 0-degree retroscope, the wide medial metaantrosomy, the partial medial maxillectomy, not the true medial maxillectomy. We began to proceed and define the exact site of origin of the papilloma from within the maxillary sinus. Removal of papilloma, more papilloma, a lot of 13 times follow up or 13 times recurrence. And that's why we were very cautious in taking care of this. Here we are, we began to press on the orbit to make sure that you see the dehiscence in the lamina. And you see here, this is the nasolacrimal duct cut intentionally. It was involved by the disease. And then we began to proceed to remove the mucosa from the, we began to utilize the 45 degree telescope and to remove the mucosa around the site of origin. And here we are. We are proceeding, utilizing the curved suction. And this is the anterior wall. You have to be able not only to visualize, but also to manipulate and remove. And what we use here, we are using the long upturned Kamel's forceps to remove the mucosa and expose the bone. Now we realize that the site of origin of the papilloma is this bony spicule. This bony spicule from the posterior part, it goes hand in hand with the expected site according to the preoperative CT and MRI. And we have to bare all the bone at the site of origin. Otherwise, this is definitely the reason or the secret of the recurrence, and recurrence. Here we are. And now, and only now, we can say we performed medial maxillectomy, transnasal, endoscopic, using the 0-degree telescope and the angle telescope and the angle tools, removal of the site of origin and bearing the bone underneath. We are lucky. We are lucky. Why? Because you see the recurrence is definitely, I don't want to say zero, but definitely less than before than external techniques. I just want to show you this. This is one of the cases 2 years after surgery, after median maxillectomy, no recurrence, lucky. And just want to show you this is a case of not only the maxillary sinus was full of fibrous tissue and no recurrence. We are lucky, we are lucky. And then we have to understand, sometimes we perform only partial median maxillectomy. There is no need to perform the whole stuff. And sure, we sometimes preserve the integrity of the inferior termic if there is no indication to remove. And again, the nasal lacrimal duct, sometimes we preserve the nasal lacrimal duct. And sometimes, no problem, we can utilize the pre-lacrimal approach to take care of the papilloma if it is feasible. And no shame, we can begin with the pre-lacrimal and end with the medial maxillectomy proper. Now we can shift to from the simple to the limited to the extended to the extended frontal drainage. When are we going to perform the external frontal drainage? Here we are. This is our current case again. If after external approach, the tumor was adherent to the medial wall of the frontal sinus to the nether to the septum in between. What we did the draft type 2B, draft type 2B, and we could reach the site of origin and utilize not only the curved bur, but the curette as well, and we removed the bone around. Another case, we cannot see bilateral affection of the papilloma. Many times recurrence with calcification inside. What we did here, we were obliged to perform draft type 3. Why? Because the two sides were involved. And here we are, in such a case, we began our work to remove the papilloma, and then we began to communicate both frontal sinus together, and then we began to deliver the papilloma from within the frontal sinus. The papilloma of the frontal sinus in such a case, because of the long-term and the multiple recurrences, was associated with calcification inside. We performed a relatively very wide draft type 3, but as you can notice, we faced a lot of difficulty to deliver all these lesions. Can you notice that at that time, we had the consent of the patient for the possibility of an external approach in case of failure to do it completely transnasal. Now we removed only the right side, and then we began to widen the draft type 3 again at the expense of the beak anteriorly. Here we are. The keel posterior, you can see the olfactory fibers posteriorly. We could not widen the opening more than this. And the mass inside was very, very big and calcified. And it was definitely a very difficult case. And here we are using the six hands technique, not only one, irrigation and suction and burr and grasping forceps and so on and the scope. And then we are using again the upturned Kamel's force longer and to deliver such a relatively big papilloma calcified. And we could deliver this big papilloma from the frontal sinus widened draft type 3, and then we began to face a big problem. How to deliver such a relatively big mass via the nostril to the extent that we spend relatively sometimes thinking of the possibility of elotomy, because again, it was difficult to deliver it via the oral cavity. But luckily, we used patience to manipulate and remove the papilloma. Mind you, in such a case, we were utilizing the navigation system to help us, and that's the end of the story. You can notice here how the cavity of the frontal sinus was taken care of. This is a site of dehiscence of the bone, but the dura was intact. We were lucky to perform such type of surgery. And definitely, whenever you are going to take care of a papilloma within the frontal sinus, draft type 3, here we are, the olfactory fibers, and the T of draft, God bless his soul. And then here we are, this is the beak anteriorly, and the keel posteriorly. And then this is the anterior wall of the frontal sinus, the posterior wall of the frontal sinus. And this is the skull base left and the skull base right. And then this is the lamina papyracea left, lamina papyracea right. And then we have to understand how to have a relatively very, very wide horseshoe appearance. But one should understand you have to follow the case meticulously to make sure that no recurrence. And just in case of recurrence, you have to rapidly interfere and take care of it. But we have to confess that in most of the cases, especially for the frontal sinus, we have to have, before surgery, a consent from the patient. In case of failure to achieve complete exposure and complete removal of the disease, one should be capable and obliged to perform an external approach. In such a case, we began endoscopic. We began endoscopic and we failed to take care of the whole stuff. And accordingly, we were obliged to begin to perform the wing incision, the wing unilateral, and then we began to perform the osteoplastic flap to expose the tumor. And we were able to deliver such a relatively big tumor within the frontal sinus, and we could remove it. You see, within a relatively big cell, we failed to remove, open the cell and deliver all the tumor from below. And then we, at the end of the story, we replaced the bone and we sutured the periosteum, and then we began to suture the skin and finish cosmetically good. And this is the case where we were obliged to perform it external. So I just want to conclude and to reach our idea. It's the origin, classification based on the origin. And accordingly, these are different types of papillomas. And these old papillomas should not be taken care of same. They are different papillomas and they are differently handled, transnasal, endoscopic, or adjuvant external. So that's the question. So lesions originating from the turbinates and or nasal septum, the case for simple resection, transnasal, anterior ethmoid, posterior ethmoid, or sphenoid, direct, the limited sphenoethmoidectomy, and then the maxillary sinus origin. This is the case for the extended medial maxillectomy. And then the frontal sinus, this is the case for the extended frontal sinusotomy. But we have to state it, all these maneuvers, they are radical. The aim of work is to remove the whole stuff, to remove the tumor completely, and we can perform it endoscopic. But the origin, I just want to show you, these are our series regarding the most common site of origin was the maxillary sinus, here we are, and then followed by the anterior ethmoid, posterior ethmoid, and sphenoid, and then the turbinate and the sphenoid, and the septum. The most important part of the lecture is the coming slide. Why? Because the recurrence in type 1, where is the origin, turbinate and or septum, no recurrence. Why? Because we removed the whole tumor with safety margin. Tumors arising from the anterior or posterior ethmoid or sphenoid, recurrence less than 10%. And then tumors arising from the maxillary sinus, median maxillectomy, recurrence less than 20%. But definitely tumors arising from the frontal sinus relatively difficult, and the origin is difficult to be handled in many cases, so recurrence is high. So to reach our conclusion, it seems that origin-based classification is a good alternative for planning surgery and expecting the recurrence. And we have to confess that the exact origin is usually finalized during surgery. So you, he or she, should be ready to to handle the papilloma and the whole range of endoscopic and external procedures. So to conclude, it's the origin again. Before I close, I just want to invite you all to come to Egypt next March, the 4th to 6th, to have a very good conference. We expected in March. It will be in person. So it's a special invitation for you. Who is attending this lecture will take a discount, 50% discount for the meeting, but definitely it will be a very good chance to visit Egypt, Cairo, and the Sphinx and our pyramid. This is was one of our meetings. Big attendance. Our Silver Jubilee was a big attendance. One of our invited guests, the pyramid, Sethi. Everybody knows Sethi. And then this is Mrs. Storrs. Mrs. Storrs was attending our meeting with a very good faculty. And this is our team. You see, like the pyramid as well. And here we are. This is our Pan-Arab Journal of Rhinology. Hopefully, you can submit your article for its online peer review. And definitely, it's a very good chance to publish your article. Before I end, I just want to invite you to download this book from Storrs company. It's free of charge, or from my website. It's the lateral nasal wall, osteometer complex, and the anterior skull base. It is a very, very simple understanding of the anatomy, and especially endoscopic and the radiologic anatomy. Our meeting, and definitely at the end of the story, I'm ready for the questions. And again and again, I would like to thank Puya Mubaraki for his kind invitation, and looking forward for the questions. Thank you very much.
I'm very glad about your presentation for the meetings, the books. Those informative material are essential, because we should be blessed because of the technology. Now we can stay everywhere in the world and be connected. And this is a whole opportunity to let the people know what we are doing, and also let the people, those one that could not be able to reach everywhere, but they can, you know, understand that we have somewhere around meetings that could be possible to be joined in live or through the internet, but also some books that are essential if you as a resident, or if you just want to approach for endoscopic sinus surgery. I think that those pillars should be managed and read before approaching to this. And the fact that we are having such a great lecture from one of the pioneers in this surgery and on those treating those diseases, I think that provide a good outstanding material for all attendees. So I have some questions from all around the world. We are having so many people connected from India, China, we have from Brazil, some of our friends from Brazil. I'm very glad that they are participating today, USA, UK, and France. So for anyone, we will start with the questions. We have already some of them. If you still have some questions, I think that Professor already sent you and presented the email. And I think that if anyone is interested, if we cannot close and reply to those questions, you can send them through his email. So the first question, of course, because of this pandemic, this is our colleagues from India, and he's asking, are you performing surgery for inverted papilloma in this unprecedented time?
In fact, regarding the situation of Asia, in our country, we are in the reopening process, and accordingly, we began to perform surgery. Regarding papilloma, we consider it one of the precancerous situations. And accordingly, now we perform surgery for the inverted papilloma during the reopening. Our situation, luckily in Egypt, is declining regarding the COVID. But definitely we have to state it. We follow all the PPE protocols regarding the masks, regarding the shield, regarding the goggles, regarding the cap, regarding the garment, regarding the room, regarding the suction, regarding the everything. So definitely we are working in a very difficult situation, but we have to offer our patients the state of the art. We stopped during the pandemic, the rising and the high rate of death, but now we began to, thanks God, to resume working and operating.
I think that this is very important to reoperate this patient, because after 6 months, I think that we already know how to deal with our personal protection. So why do we have to participate in such precancerous lesion, as you say? And in fact, this is the last, the other question regarding this. Do you recommend multiple biopsies for an inverted papilloma arising from the posterior part of the maxillary sinus?
Definitely, not only multiple biopsies. I send all the removed all the material. I send it all to the histopathology, and should be a very good histopathological the lab to be capable of serial cutting of the removed material to exclude the possibility of malignancy. Definitely, sometimes I suspect a part of malignancy. But this is not the situation. All the removed material should be sent for the histopathological evaluation.
Another question from YouTube. This is our question is, I don't understand exactly what he's trying to say, but is a place for HPV in inverted papilloma and how to avoid recurrence?
The human papilloma virus, the human papilloma virus, in fact, I don't have a good experience with the human papilloma virus and the NSAID and, but definitely a lot of literature suggesting that the high titer of the human papilloma virus, the bad indicator of the human papilloma virus, gives the impression that this may be associated with malignancy. But I don't have a good experience with the human papilloma virus.
Yes. Another question is regarding imaging. Our colleagues from Singapore is asking, would you recommend MRI with contrast, or you just suggesting CT scan and MRI?
In most of the cases, we depend on the MRI and CT. And CT, basically, we don't ask for anything else. And in most of the cases, we succeed to anticipate the site of origin from the beginning. And I showed you the speculum bone, the calcification. The MRI is very, very nice for the falciform appearance. It's the origin is there. So if the CT and MRI co-opt with the expected site of origin in most of the cases, but we have to confess that the only proof is during surgery. We have to follow the papilloma, follow till the site of origin. This is the exact site of origin. So one should be malleable for handling the papilloma.
Another question is coming from Spain, and the colleague is asking, if the inverted papilloma is arising from the nasal septum, are you removing the bony the bone and the cartilage?
In fact, the most behaving type of papilloma is that type arising from the nasal septum. It's not a common happening, relatively rare in our series, but it's very good prognosis. What we usually do to follow the papilloma to the site of origin, and what we usually do is nothing, mycoperiosteal surrounding the papilloma, we remove it, and then we bare the bone. We don't remove the whole bone. In most of the cases of the papilloma of the septum, histopathology is basically exophytic, not endophytic. Exophytic, usually very good prognosis. Endophytic goes with the inverted papilloma.
Another question from, please, if anyone is attending, type where are you from, because we will be able to understand where are you from, and we will add this. We don't want to speak about names. So whatever. Anyway, this question is coming from the same colleagues before. It say, if the pathologist will tell you there is an association carcinoma with an inverted papilloma, what would you do?
The question again, please.
I think that the question is that if the anatomopathologist with the frozen section will tell you there's an association with the carcinoma with the inverted papilloma, what would you do?
In case of associated malignancy, I have to resort to the oncology team, and we follow matter. in some cases, it is very, very in situ or very limited within the material. And in these cases, we follow the case only. But sometimes if it is a relatively aggressive involvement, we handle the case exactly like the associated carcinoma, squamous cell carcinoma of the maxillary, squamous carcinoma of the ethmoid, and accordingly, they usually go for the radio chemotherapy.
Another question from Brazil. Our colleague is asking, what's your post-operative protocol? Are you recommending every month for the first year, or are you recommending the first 3 months, then 6 months, then 1 year, and every 1 year for 5 years?
In fact, very variable, and we are changing. We are changing. What we usually do is to perform monthly visits for the first 6 months, and then every 3 months for the next year, and then every 6 months for the next years. Years means we do not stop, except if the patient is lost, because we have recurrences after eight years. Recurrence, primary site, but in fact, recurrence after 8 years. So it seems that how long? It seems it's lifelong because of the possibility of recurrence at the same time or second pathology, developed papilloma as well. So that's why we usually advise our patients to keep on the follow-up lifelong.
Another question from the US. It's very early, I think, over there. So the question is, what are your surgical plan if you have involvement from the lacrimal pathways?
This is a very interesting question. Whenever the lesion is arising from the lacrimal apparatus or we have to understand it's not from the lacrimal duct, the nasal lacrimal duct, it's okay, but not from the lacrimal gland, it's from the nasal lacrimal or the sac itself. So whenever the nasal lacrimal duct is involved by the disease, we cut it intentionally. And we have to confess, at the beginning, we used to perform the application of a silicone rod to make sure that there is no stenosis or closure. But by time, we realized that if you cut the nasal lacrimal duct near to the sac and sharp cut, but with safety margin, no stenosis, and we stopped applying any silicone rod. But usually we cut the duct and send it for the histopathological evaluation. And sometimes we preserve it if it is not involved by the disease.
Another question from Iraq, and the colleagues is asking, what are the limits of the endoscopic procedures for inverted papilloma?
This is very, very smart question. Very smart question. And maybe I understand who said it, but very smart, very smart question. Accordingly, the limit is yours. So it depends on the experience. And the aim of work is not a shame at all to perform radical antrum, external frontal, external whatsoever. The aim of work is to save the patient and to remove the whole stuff and offer him the best, and you remove the site of origin and offer him no recurrence. So there is no shame to utilize whatsoever. But in my own experience and following and growing through the learning curve and the tools and I understand now lesions are originating from the septum, turbinate, ethmoid, sphenoid, and maxillary. All of these lesions could be handled with care using the endoscope, whatsoever the site of origin within the maxillary sinus. In my own and in the experience of many well-trained endoscopists, the problem is basically with the frontal sinus. The frontal sinus is a difficult sinus to handle. And to take care of the origin, this is the most important part. You can remove it, but to follow and to identify the site of origin, this is the story. So we understand that the recurrent frontal sinus papilloma should be handled with utmost care. if you fail to perform endoscopic transnasal care of complete removal of the papilloma, you can perform the osteoplastic flap with good cosmetic results and remove the whole papilloma and bear the site of origin and offer your patient the best. So it seems that the limit of endoscopic is frontal, not only lateral, but also the anterior wall of the posterior. But definitely whenever it is usually medial to the lamina papyracea, maybe easy. But papilloma of the frontal sinus is naughty, and the incidence of recurrence is relatively high.
Time for the last questions. For anyone interested, please type your questions or directly to the email from Professor Reda Kamel, because we don't have the time. This is very interesting case, and the question is from Poland. What was the first case you have done, and what are the results of it?
I have to confess, this is a very smart question. The first case was a patient. I remember this patient, she was Nadia Hussein. To that extent, I remember her name. She was relatively old at that time. I was very, very young. She may not be there now, but God, anyhow, what happened? It was polyps. At that time, it was end of 80s. At that time, I began to take care of the polyps, because papilloma at that time was not an issue for endoscopic. And I began to remove the polyps, came from the frontal, from the maxillary sinus. I removed the polyp. I had to perform a relatively wide millimeter antrostomy. So I sent the rule was to send it for the histopathology. I sent it for the histopathology. It was invert papilloma. How to manage with my professor? You understand, the professor at that time was a big professor. So if the professor realized that you did this bad type of surgery, endoscopic at that time, the endoscopic surgery was not popular. And our seniors were not fond of endoscopic at all. So what I followed that up. Next time, I began to perform a very wide millimeter antrostomy, partial median maxillectomy, and I realized that the origin is within the maxillary sinus. So from that time, from the first beginning of my experience, I realized it's not the extent of papilloma. You may have a very big and a huge papilloma. And at the end of the story, you follow it, and you realize the site of origin is nothing but the lateral nasal wall, middle turbinate, and the bulla epidermis. And in many cases, it's pedicled. How comes? Once upon a time, all papillomas were taking care of lateral rhinotomy and the medial maxillectomy. So we are lucky. I'm lucky as well, because you see, I have relatively white hair. So I definitely attended the evolution of how to handle papilloma from the far beginning of the lateral rhinotomy, medial maxillectomy, to the midfacial degloving, to the limited lesion, to the more extensive lesion, to the origin, and who knows what's coming later on. So we have to wait and see. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the brilliant presentation. You express exactly the meaning of what are the limits, but also what are the starts. And I think that if anyone would like to improve their technique, one of the things that is mandatory by now are dissection courses, which are available worldwide. Technology is essential. If you want to approach to lesions that are very advanced, like you said, for the frontal involvement, if you have combined or very huge problems, you need a trained team, because it's all about the team. And then you need preparation. And the preparation has been offered now. So you, everyone having the possibility to learn, so the chances to get better are very, very high. But the problem is that sometimes the people don't understand that if you want to approach such lesions, you have to do slowly and increasing your techniques. And to do this, you have to go back and watch your first steps. So as you said, in the beginning, in the early 90s, probably the chief and the boss was the one that was deciding. Now you have the capability to understand what are your limits. And if you don't have the time to go and fast forward, you have to go back, train again, and go forward. And for this, that's why our essential courses, congresses, and books, anatomy, as you say. I'm very pleased to have you, for having you here, and I hope that in the future you will be able to attend once again one of our ground rounds.
Thank you very much, Puya, and looking forward to see you back, and see you in Egypt next March, inshallah.
Inshallah. For the last time, advertising, I would love to all the attendees remembering that we have to go back with Jivian Lee for the novel surgical procedure for recalcitrant chronic sinusitis, which has been canceled before because of a technical issue from her. So we are planning this once again for the 14th. Then of October 15, we are having the special announcement from the woman in rhinology section from the American Rhinologic Society for fungal rhinosinusitis. So with different speakers. Thank you so much, Professor Reda Kamel. Thank you all the attendees from all around the world for your time. And I hope to see you very soon. Goodbye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.